Good morning. Before we get started today, let's go through our troubleshooting slides. If you can see me and you can hear me and you're getting tired of hearing me say those things, then let me tell you a little bit about last week's broadcast. We had, throughout the week, we had over 46 devices and households tuning in, which is fantastic. That means that we're getting lots of people watching. And hopefully some new people experiencing. I want to tell you some cool international views this week, but we didn't have any, which is also okay. The internet's a weird place. Maybe we got some over in on YouTube. But wherever you're watching, wherever you're finding yourself today, I'm glad that you're here. I'm glad that you're able to be a part of what we're doing. Each week, I encourage you to take a picture while you're worshiping, especially on Communion Sundays or things like that, but having like the new church logo in the background or just like this whole screen so we can see what you're doing. So I want to share some of those pictures with you today in a video montage. Check it out. Thank you everyone for participating. That was from the past 2 weeks. This next week, I'm hoping that you can take a time during the worship here and take a picture, but then also sometime during this week, you can wear some of your church garb, your church you could represent out in the community and snap a picture. Somewhere fun, somewhere sunny, somewhere cool, wherever you're finding yourself. This is kind of like my closing, go now and make disciples. Wherever you are going, take a picture in your Emmanuel UMC shirt or hat or whatever, with a big smile on your face, and we can share that next week. So hopefully you have gone, rebooted, and come back, or whatever you need to do to get this Facebook Live running, or if you head over to our website, you're watching on the New Church tab through the website's YouTube connection. Either case, buckle up, because we're about to start our brand new episode of New Church right now. Good morning, I'm Pastor Kellen Rogenbuck, and I am the pastor of Emmanuel United Methodist Church, and I am so excited to bring you a new episode of New Church. New Church is our digital expression of worship here at Emmanuel United Methodist Church. We started this back when we started social distancing in this time of COVID, and so you can't come to us, so wherever the internet reaches in this grand world that we live in, we're able to worship right there with you. Let us take a moment to prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Whenever you are watching this, wherever you are watching this, we are all connected as one body and one voice as we lift up this song together in praise of our Lord. Please join me.
Savior, I fell far from above. I've been down to the river. I ain't the same, a prodigal return. Oh, all my hope is in Jesus. Thank God my yesterday's gone. All my sins are forgiven. I've been washed by the blood. the prison. I've worn shackles and chains, but I've been freed and forgiven. I'm not going back, I'll never be the same. Oh, all my hope is in Jesus. Thank God my yesterday's gone. All my sins are forgiven. I've been washed by the blood. All my hope is in Jesus. Thank God my yesterday's gone. All my sins are forgiven. I've been washed by the blood. I've been washed by the blood.
One of the things we do every time we gather to worship, even as part of New Church, is that we pray for one another. We do this because we're supposed to be in constant communication with God. We are in relationship with God, but we want to lift up the people around us and the things in our community that are matter to us and matter to the people that we care about. Over on our Facebook page, we have a pinned, right up at the top, a pinned post that you can drop prayer concerns in all week. But you can also contact me. I want to share some of the ones that were shared with me this week. And then hopefully you can share some in the future. So this week, first, Eric, you might remember, we've been praying about Eric's feet for some time now because he had some surgeries and he's been cleared to return to work. And that's great news for them. Great news for Eric. So we're going to pray, like, first a prayer of thanksgiving, but then also a prayer that his health is continually growing forward and that he can stay on his feet for that amount of time. Steve Miller has been accepted into the MSW. Now, Steve, if I'm wrong, please correct me, but I believe that's the Masters of Social Work program at UW, and he's starting this September. So first, good job, smart guy. And second, we want to pray for the family as they transition into additional work and time with Steve away and things like that. So we want to pray for that whole situation. I heard from the Wendt family this week, and a family friend of theirs actually lost her son in a drowning accident. And so we want to be praying for her family and also the Wendts and everyone who's been touched by this tragedy. It's never easy, but this is very sad, and we want to be praying for comfort and patience. And boy, I'm so sorry, guys. We'll be praying for you. I also would like to make sure we spend some time this week thinking about the graduates. This is kind of the beginning of what would have been graduation party season, when we would be able to get together and celebrate those who have accomplished something great, like graduating high school or college. And so we want to think about, in this strange time that we're living in, what it must be like to have this accomplishment and not be able to celebrate it with the people that we love and helped us get to where we're at. So for the graduates out there, we want to be praying first a prayer of thanksgiving for you, a congratulatory prayer, but also a prayer that you understand that we still care about you and we're sorry that things went this way. During this time of prayer, I will begin us, but then we'll have a time of stillness. And during the stillness, I encourage you to pray for some of the things that we talked about here today, but also the things that are going on in your life that I haven't shared. This is also a time for you to leave space for God to speak back to you. At the end of this stillness, I will call us back in prayer, and we will pray the Lord's Prayer. Now, the way I'm going to say it will be displayed on the screen, and you can say it along in that same way. Or if you learned it differently, I really would like you to feel comfortable to say it in the way that you learned to say it. I think that's really important. I don't mind if it's different than the way that I say it, and I know that God doesn't mind. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you today as we lift up the exciting things going on in our world, the sort of reintroduction into what might be some normal life, We also want to be mindful of the people whose lives have been changed irreparably during this time of quarantine, the graduates or the people who weren't able to go to funerals, the people who had to reschedule weddings, and these things that will never be the same. And we want to lift up also those who have lost people during this time, which, whether it's during COVID or not, it's still very hard. We ask that you lay your blessings upon us and that you be with us as we heal in this time. Hear the prayers of your children. Lord, we know that you hear our prayers, and we trust that you are faithful. Make yourself known in our lives as in your time and as you see fit. Communicate that you are with us. Help us be comforted by your presence. Let us know that you celebrate when we celebrate and that you mourn when we mourn. And we ask all of these things as faithful disciples, and we come together in one voice in discipleship with the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." If you have a prayer concern you'd like to have be a part of New Church so that everyone who's watching this can be praying for you, please contact me or head over to the Facebook page and check out that pinned post, like I said. We also have a prayer team that prays for all of the concerns that we get throughout the week. So even if you don't want it to be a part of New Church, contact us and let us know, and we'll be praying for you throughout the week. This week, we continue our sermon series, Tales from the Youth Room. If you are just watching this for the very first time, before I was pastor here at Emmanuel, I had worked for 12 years in youth ministry. It's a great passion of mine. It's something that I adore with all of my heart. I've worked for 4 different churches in different capacities doing youth ministry. I was a youth ministry consultant. I still write articles and things like that around youth ministry. It's very important to me. And my absolute favorite thing is interacting with teenagers. They are just the craziest, funniest, strangest, most compassionate, wonderful, confusing demographic of people I've ever done ministry with. And I adore my time doing that. And there's times in working with teenagers that I have glimpsed something profound, something that the Holy Spirit is trying to teach me through a situation. And that's what this series is all about, is me sharing some of those truths, those things that I learned about God or about faith or about the world through interacting with teenagers, and hopefully having some fun along the way, because these stories are all things that I enjoy. I like to reminisce and tell stories. But this week, I actually want to start with a scripture, this is a scripture that needs a little introduction. If you're not familiar with Elijah is a prophet. He's a mouthpiece for God, and God speaks to him, and he brings this message to the people. Elijah actually did a lot of work outside of his country, outside of the chosen people of God, which was really confusing for a lot of people. They said, this is, you are a, you're our prophet. This is our God. Why are you going abroad? And why are you going and talking with these heathens, the people who believe in these gods we don't believe in? But Elijah went out and he helped and he taught people about God. But in today's story, there reaches a point where God says to Elijah, go up on the mountain. I'm going to meet you. I'm going to be there with you. Now, this happens almost never in the Bible. There's a time where it happened with Moses, and God was like, Moses, go hide behind a rock. I'm going to walk by, but if you look upon my face, you will surely die. So there's actually this story, and this might be a fun sermon in the future, where Moses is like hiding behind a rock, and he like peeks, and he sees the backside of God as God walks away. So like he sees God's back. But Elijah's told, go up on the mountain, and I just want to be there with you, and I want to talk to you. And so that's the setup for today's scripture. As Elijah is going up on the mountain, and so this comes from 1 Kings, it's chapter 19. If you want to follow along, it's going to be verses 11 and 12. If you want to hear some more of the backstory to this, or just want to know more about Elijah, 1 Kings is full of Elijah's ministry, but I'm going to have it up on the screen, what I read right here, so hear the word of the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great strong wind tore into the mountains and broke the rocks into pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a great fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a still, small voice. Last week, we talked about Jackson on mission trip, right? And I have lots of stories from mission trip. Part of that is because I've been on, I think, 21 mission trips in my life. And so if you think of anything you've done 21 times, you've probably developed some stories around it. But the one I'm going to tell you about today, this also took place in Tennessee. This was in Cosby, Tennessee, which is about an hour away from Greenville. So in the same region that the last story took place, but several years before. So this is with a church from Lake Zurich, Illinois. And I was up there with a large group of teenagers. And one of the things that we were doing as part of our day off, so when we're there, I like to work for, we work for 4 of the 5 days. Every once in a while, we'll work a half day. In addition to that, we'll do our day off. We'll work in the morning. But if we're really doing well, and I push the teenagers really hard to make sure that we get as much work done as possible. But while we're there, I also like to explore Appalachia a little bit with the youth. We go whitewater rafting. We do some devotionals. We do some prayer time. The kind of things you need to spiritually recharge right in the middle of the week. So what we did as part of this one is it's the first time I'd ever done this on a mission trip. I challenged the youth to go off. They had to be within shouting distance. I had a bullhorn. They had to be within bullhorn distance of hearing me tell them when the hour was done because they weren't allowed to have their cell phones. But they had to go off, and they didn't have to be alone per se, but they had to be silent. So like if you saw someone, that was okay, but you couldn't talk to them. You just had to be silent. I wanted them to be aware of what's going on inside them and have some stillness in their life. This actually is a big part of the language I use for our prayer when I say we'll have a moment of stillness. This is what we're looking for, is this centering and this stillness that I was asking these teenagers to do. So I sent them all off. They all went, some went up the mountain, some went down the other side of the mountain. Others went off to the pavilion or the picnic tables or stuff like that. And they just had to be still and silent and quiet. You know, they couldn't talk. And trying to walk around and make sure everyone's doing what they're supposed to be doing during this time, I sort of come over the crest of a hill and into some like wooded area, and I hear something, and I'm pretty sure it's someone's voice. And this is like literally the only thing I told them they can't do. So I'm trying to go find out who's talking and not listening to what I had said. And so I come up upon like a very overgrown trail, or maybe not even a trail, maybe just like very thin brush. And there's a young lady there, we'll call her Jessica. Jessica is climbing through the brush, and she's like narrating what's happening to her. You know, it's like this like constant stream of things coming out of her mouth, and she's, there's this stump, and it's, there's ants on the stump, and I don't think I can stand on it. I think it's going to crumble, and I shouldn't have worn my flip-flops, and this doesn't seem like a path, and I can't believe this. And so I walked over to her, and I said, Jessica, what are you doing? And she said, what? I'm doing what we're supposed to do. And I said, but you're talking. She looked at me surprised. She said, no, I'm not. I said, yes, you are. You're talking. You just don't talk. Just like be out here and be quiet. She goes, that's exactly what I'm doing. I said, Jessica, you're not. But okay, go ahead. And she turned around and she took a couple steps and she just, I'm not talking. I don't even know what he's talking about. I don't know where I'm supposed to go because it's all this way. I said, Jessica, you're doing it right now. You are talking. Stop it. And she looked at me and she, okay. And I couldn't believe, I mean, she was arguing with me about whether or not she was saying words. Like she was incapable of realizing she was talking right then. And it really clued me into this sort of thought of how we are when it comes to our world and sound and distraction. And in this moment, Jessica could not be silent, could not be still. She was so uncomfortable with that she was literally narrating all of her thoughts out loud. And so when I think of the Elijah story or I think about the Jessica story, it reminds me of the other one. Of this time that like Elijah was in, he was in the wilderness. He was up on this mountainside. Both of these stories take place in the wilderness on the mountainside. And he was in this place and there was this mighty wind. It tore down. It was so hard that the wind was bursting rocks apart. Like you even know how loud and gusty wind can be. I grew up in outside Chicago, the windy city. There was times where like you could lean into the wind and it's blowing past you and it's so loud and so intense. It was even more than that. It was breaking rocks. That's how much this mighty wind was blowing. But God wasn't in that wind. God wasn't in the sound or the power or the raw aggression of this wind. That wasn't God. And then after there's a great mighty earthquake and the rocks are tumbling down and trees are falling over. But even in this display of power and physicality, like God wasn't in that either. And then after that, this roaring fire comes sweeping through the mountainside. This giant forest fire comes surging by. But the text tells us the Lord was not in the fire. It wasn't until after all of these things had happened that Elijah experienced God. And it was in a still, small voice. That's the translation a lot of translations, you could translate it to say in the silence, in the stillness, in the void away from sound is where God was. Jessica is a pseudonym, so I have to keep thinking in my mind of Jessica, not the actual name. Jessica found herself in this time where she was really struggling. She is used to having a life full of cell phones and music and school and stress and people talking at you and being social. She was a very social person. And all of this was like noise in her life. Like, yes, auditory noise, but also distraction, right? And I wanted to do this story and this message as a follow-up to 2 weeks ago when we were talking about prayer. Because prayer, as I said, is just a conversation. We talk to God, and then we leave space for God to talk back. But for some of us, that's the hardest part. For Jessica, that was the hardest part, was just being still. For just being willing to, like, calmly and quietly listen. To open herself up to the possibility that there are things that she needs to experience outside of herself. To set down some of the distractions and noise in her life. Now, I've had times in my life, and I'm guessing some of you out there are right there with me, where like it feels like the earth beneath your feet is shaking, right? You've had the earthquakes in your life, or you've had the rushing winds. There's times of devastation where we've had this, you know, it felt like a fire sweep through my world, right? And in all of these things, these are all big and powerful and crazy and distracting. But God wasn't speaking through those things. It wasn't until after that Elijah could hear God in this still, small voice. This is what we are challenged to do. This is why I was having Jessica be quiet. This is why every time we pray, I give you a moment of stillness. So hopefully, even for 30 seconds, you're opening yourself up to hear just a word. In Minneapolis, there's the Orfield Laboratories, right? They have what's called the world's quietest room. It's a space that they've created. I'm going to put a picture up because it looks like a nightmare. It's these jutting spikes and all of these crazy looking things to deaden the acoustics. The acoustics there they register under 0 decibels. It's lined with fiberglass and soundproofing. So when you are in this room, you cannot hear anything. No vibrations make it to your ears. It's the word that people use to describe this is unsettling. What happens is you start to like hear your own body. You hear your heartbeat. You hear the blood rushing through your veins. You hear your lungs contracting and expanding. Your stomach, your intestines, all of a sudden that's all you can hear. You are in this moment of absolute still silence. And people find it unsettling. They find it disturbing. There's actually, I don't know what it is, I should have looked it up for this sermon. There's actually like a record for who could stay in there the longest. And it's not very long because it is so disturbing for people. And that's my point. We have created a society that has so much noise and distraction and chaos and urgency and busyness and complications that it's so hard to just pause, to just be still. When we're still, it can feel unsettling. When we are still, it can feel like we are wasting our time. For some of us, it even takes time to get into the stillness, even when we understand the value of it and the practice of it. What I want you to try to do this week is after you pray every single day, devote as much time as you can carve out. If it's an hour, great. If it's 15 minutes, it's going to be hard, but do your best. And I want you to find an opportunity to be still. Separate yourself from all of the things in your life that are windy or earthquakey or fiery. All of the things that are demanding your attention right this moment. Get them away from you. Clear them out of your head. Breathe. And open yourself up for the still small voice. The fancy word we use in the church for this is discernment. We use this to listen to God and see what God has in store for us. And I can promise you, God has something to say. Whether it's to say, I am proud of you, good and faithful servant. Or to weigh in on your decisions. Or even all the things that you pray for God to be saying, I hear you. I am with you. We need to be still to experience that. So, like Elijah on the mountainside, like Jessica on the mountainside, I'm asking, prepare yourself. Look past the wind and the earthquake and the fire, because the Lord is not in those. After the fire came a still, small voice. And if you listen, I promise God is speaking. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, come to us in our stillness. Help us to calm, to center, to listen. Help us to find what you are trying to tell us in these moments. Lead us to the place that you want us to be, to the points you want us to hear. Do this in our stillness so that we may understand and seek more stillness in our lives. And all God's children said, amen. Whenever we hear the word of God, we should be called to action. One action we take every time that we gather and worship is to give back to the community through the church. I want you to understand that phrase, give back to the community through the church. Because our goal here is to make our community closer to the kingdom of God. So that when we open our doors and we go out into the world, we see more of Christ in it than we did the day before. That is our goal. And so what we do is we rally our resources, our people, our volunteer time, our talents, and our finances. We push them all together so we can make the biggest impact possible. And we do this in our community, in Jefferson County. We are working to be Christ to those people. And in a time when it's really hard to go out and help in the way that we normally do, the church is still really working hard to do that. So if that's something you want to support, there are two ways that you can help do that. And I ask that you really prayerfully consider this. Maybe take it to God and pray about how you can best support the community through the church. One way is that you can mail in some sort of support. This is our address here if you want to do that. The other thing you can do is you can head over to emmanueljefferson.com and click our giving tab. And on there you can set up an online giving, which you can use your bank account or your credit card. However you want to be supportive in that way, we want to help facilitate that so that we can do the absolute most for the community here and we can bring the good news, the gospel, to as many people as possible. Let us take another moment to come together as one voice in many places and at many different times through the magic of technology and the internet to lift up one song to our triune God who is good and that we love. Please join me.
The King of Love, my shepherd, is whose goodness faileth never. I'm nothing like if I am his, and he is mine forever, and he is mine forever. Where streams of living water flow, so he leadeth, and where the verdant pastures grow, with food celestial feeding. Never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting. The and foolish, off astray. But yet in love he sought me, and on his shoulder gently lay, and home rejoicing brought me. In death's dark veil I fear no ill, with thee, dear Lord, beside me. Thy rod and staff my comfort still, thy cross before to guide me.
If the music in worship is something that you are lacking in your life, that you are missing from our in-person worships, I encourage you to check out the Spotify app. This is something that you can get on your computer or on your cell phone. If you go over and you get your Spotify app, you can find the Emmanuel UMC worship playlist. This has almost all the songs that we use from Sunday to Sunday. They're on a playlist, so you can listen and you can worship wherever you find yourself and wherever you are in need of that music that just, it amps me up. And I know some of you are the same way, so check it out over on Spotify. Before we close today, I wanted to take a moment to point out that a survey went out to the Emmanuel UMC church family regarding the transition back into in-person worship. I know some people who watch New Church online here might not have received that email. So if you want to be a participant of that survey, I would like you to contact me or contact the church. Now, the survey is for people who are going to be moving into a place of in-person worship when Emmanuel opens its doors again. So if that describes you, if you're going to come and be a part of our in-person worship with the same community that we are building here at New Church, then please check your email inboxes. It went out on Friday, and fill out that survey, get it back to us, because leadership is going to be discussing what we learned from that this coming week. And if you didn't receive one because for whatever reason, contact me, contact the church. You can do that through Facebook, through the website, through Instant Messenger, whatever, however you want to get a hold of me, I will get you that survey because I value your input. If you are hearing my voice and seeing my face right now, I want to hear from you about what might come in the future here. So please take a moment to fill that survey out and get it back to us. And that's what we got this week for a new church. We ask you to do a couple things. First, if you could like, share, follow, comment on this video. It's a great way to tell the people in your life that this is something that they should check out and that you value. It's the easiest way to tell people, to point people towards the gospel and to hear important messages like we have here. Jesus told his disciples to go now and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. This is crucial. This is the backbone of discipleship, is to wherever we are find ourselves to be telling people about Jesus Christ. But today I want you to also be thinking about wherever you find yourself to carve out a niche where you can be still and you can hear what God is telling you to do in that place. This is how we take our charge of being disciples to all people and the guidance of the Holy Spirit, and we can bring them together into what we are supposed to do as disciples. So listen and follow. May God bless and keep you. I miss you. I will hopefully see you soon. Fill out your surveys. Thanks, folks. Have a good week.